Obviously, none of us are real thrilled about the snow, but I just keep reminding myself that, you know what, it could be a lot worse than snow. We could be dealing with flooding, we could be dealing with fires, we could be dealing with, you know, something so much worse. And we know that spring is going to come. We're not quite sure when. I was on Facebook this morning and they were showing people digging out and said, preparing for the 4th of July parade is what they were doing. But, you know, it is always a privilege for us to gather together, and it's a privilege for us to be able to worship. And so as we get started today, I'm going to ask you to please stand, and together let's just lift up some praise to the good Lord.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of
turned into wine. open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then what could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And what could stand against? Is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Stand against.
Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this opportunity we have this morning to be able to come into your presence, to be able to gather and worship, to be able to encourage each other, to be able to recognize that you are an all-powerful and almighty God. And even in the last day and a half here, we have seen the power that you can bring about. Lord, we pray blessing upon this time. And I just pray and ask that your Holy Spirit would be in this place. Just continue to be with us as we have this opportunity to just worship you. And we ask this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Sing with us one more song together.
Thank you.
Why don't you go ahead and take the opportunity to greet and say hello to those that are around you. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Go ahead and be seated. A couple announcements that I want to bring to your attention. First of all, you'll probably notice congratulations and a celebration to Ed and Leona Mendering. They're celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary today, and that's always such a wonderful accomplishment. And we not only pray blessing upon them, but this afternoon, an opportunity for them to be able to spend some time together and have that celebration. They were supposed to do it yesterday, and of course, everything has changed, and that's good. Also, just to remind you, we are looking to hire a sound technician and that job opening. You'll find more information in the bulletin on that. We have a couple missions trips that you have opportunities for. One to Romania, May 11 through 19, if you're interested. And if that's the case, contact Lennis Harberts. Otherwise, the high school kids are inviting you to missions trip to Rockport, Texas. That's July 8 through the 12th. And if you're interested in that one, talk to Josh about that. Also want to remind you at the end of this week, there's a fundraiser that's going to be held for Mike Kreienbrink at the school. You'll find information in the bulletin about that. I encourage you to read that. And then tomorrow night, the consistory meets. And if anyone is interested in profession of faith, we would love for you to join us at the elders meeting. If you are interested, please just let me know so we have a heads up. But otherwise, you can keep them in your prayers as we gather. I see we're supposed to have an announcement for Bible school. Are we still doing that here this morning, or are we going to wait till next week with that? Today? All right, here we go.
So we just wanted to give you a little sneak peek of what's to come for Bible school this summer. Bible school will be held June 4 through 8 from 5:30 to 8:30, and we are still looking for some volunteers. The sign-up sheets will be back in the back of church again after the celebration this afternoon, but main leader areas that we have opportunities for are with Imagination Station, games, and then we're also still looking for co-directors to help be assistant this year, and then the directors next year. So if you're interested or know of somebody who might be interested in any of those, please have them sign up in the back or see either Kelsey or myself. Also, just a reminder that we're doing things a little bit differently this year with an online registration. So kids especially, if you sign up in the back, make sure to complete the online form too. We'll put the link has been in the bulletin, but I'm going to try to get it on Facebook this week with church too. So if you have any questions, let us know. Thanks.
Thank you. Encourage you just to take note of that. It's always a great week to be able to be here and do ministry to our kids, not only our own kids, but it's a wonderful ministry for the kids within our community. Let's go to our Lord for just a time of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, as we come before you on this day, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to be able to be here, to know that you're a God that loves us, a God that cares for us, a God that has taken the sin away within our lives as we walk in a relationship with you so that we can experience your mercy and your grace. Lord, as we come before you today, we pray that you be with the many different things that are happening here within the church. And today especially, Lord, I just lift up Daily Vacation Bible School. We know that's about a month and a half away, just a little bit more than that. We pray that you will give guidance and direction not only to the directors, but also to those who are willing to give their time and energy to continue to bring a beautiful message to our children of who you are. Lord, we pray that you will be with that week. We pray that you will open up the hearts of children to want to come and be a part of that week, and we look forward to what you're going to do with that week. As we come before you today, Lord, we praise and we thank you for the beauty of marriage, and we thank you that Ed and Leona are able to celebrate 50 years. What a wonderful blessing that is, especially in our world today. I think we're going to see less and less of those kinds of couples being married for that amount of time, and we pray a blessing upon them, and thank you for just the beautiful statement of marriage, that an example that they set. I pray, Lord, that you will just be with us as a church as we have consistory tomorrow night. And we ask that your hand will give guidance and direction to us as we meet. Lord, we look forward to some individuals coming to profess their faith and share the impact that you have made upon their lives, and we celebrate that. But Lord, be with the other work that is at hand, and we may get those things done. Lord, we thank you that you have answered prayer, and pray that you just continue to be with Wilma Lusink. We thank you that her test results came back very positive, as best as could be expected, and we praise you for that, but just continue to be with her. We think of people like Mike Kreinbrink, who has been dealing with cancer for so long, and Lord, we know it has just taken a major toll on his body, and as we think about this fundraiser for him, it's an opportunity for us to express and let him know that we care and are concerned and continue to lift him up in prayer. Lord, we think of the missions trips that are being planned, whether it's to Romania or Houston or for the college kids trip, and ask that your hand be upon each one of them. And already you're preparing hearts for those trips and an opportunity for them not only to do physical work, but also that they might be challenged spiritually in the different things that they do. And Lord, I pray that you just continue to be with everyone in this day. We know the weather isn't what we would want it to be, and yet we know there's a lot of people that maybe have to travel, that are getting out and about, and we just pray for safety. We pray that you watch over them. We pray that there is no harm. We think of our kids, Lord, as they are going to be celebrating prom, and we ask there too that you watch over them, that you protect them, and just be with them and allow them to make smart and wise decisions. And Lord, I pray that you continue to challenge us in your word, challenge us as we lift up our prayers to you, challenge us in such a way that we not only grow in our personal walk with you, but we develop a passion within our heart to want to tell other people about you. Give us those opportunities. Just lead us and guide us and direct us. And Lord, we thank you for this avenue of prayer. And we now have the opportunity to get into your word. And we pray that as we do so, you will bring blessing to it. And we just ask these things in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. So today we are starting a new series. We're going to be looking at the book of Amos. It's only about 5 weeks long. There's 9 chapters. And so you're probably thinking, okay, you know, We're going to go through this pretty fast, and at some point we are, but most of the chapters aren't very long that we go through. I should ask if there's any other kids that need to go to children's church. You can be dismissed if that's the case. So we'll let you guys go. Anyway, just maybe a little bit of background about Amos. He was present in the 8th century B.C. The years very specifically were 760 B.C. to 755. So only about 5 years did he do ministry. King Jeroboam II was king and ruler at this time when Amos brought this prophetic message to Israel from God. And maybe one of the interesting things was Amos was basically prophesying to Israel at the same time that Jonah was sent by God from Israel to prophesy to the city of Nineveh. And I think most of you know the story of Jonah as a prophet. He was to go to Nineveh. He was going to deliver the message to them. One part of the message was Israel was the success Israel was having. They were prosperous. God was increasing their borders under King Jeroboam. And at the same time, the message was that if Nineveh didn't get their act together, he was going to destroy them. And of course, Jonah didn't want to go. He was very reluctant. He was afraid of how the people were going to respond, and he's probably the more famous of obviously the two prophets of this time, very simply because his story is a little bit more memorable of being thrown into the ocean and swallowed up by a fish and ultimately spit back onto the shoreline, and then ultimately Jonah went to Nineveh. But really, the reality of it is when you compare Jonah with Amos, Amos had probably the tougher of the two jobs because Amos was going to go to his nation, the nation of Israel, and sort of wake them up to maybe some of the things that were happening within in that nation. Amos was called by God. He was a shepherd from a tiny little village in Judea called Tekoa. And as a shepherd, he just sort of was obscure. Tekoa was a town that was incredibly small. It was the kind of thing where if you blinked your eyes, you would miss it. I would compare it to somewhere like a Cloverdale, where you really have no reason to go there for anything in particular. That's the town that Amos was from. But it was during this time that God called Amos to prophesy that Israel was incredibly powerful, it was incredibly prosperous, and they were continuing to expand their borders. They were taking over nation after nation. This is not too long after they basically spent all that time in the wilderness. They had crossed the Jordan River, and they started conquering nations. The Amalekites were the first of them, and they started taking them over, and God was bringing them into this land of milk and honey, and God was allowing them this wealth and this prosperity. They were confident in their heritage. They were confident in who they were, and they often carried the model that as they went to battle with these different nations, God is with us. And so Amos is called by God in this time to come to them, and basically his message is going to be, you know what, guys, God is not real impressed with you. He's not impressed with your military might. He's not impressed with your wealth. And he's not impressed ultimately with your self-indulgent lifestyle. Now, Amos would challenge the Israelites mostly in his message with this issue of God is looking for justice for the poor and ultimately the oppressed. And as a rich and powerful nation, Israel was really sort of taking advantage of those kinds of people. And as Amos started to speak these words, his message ultimately was going to bring an uproar into the nation of Israel. The high priest Amaziah would call him a traitor. He was basically looked at as an individual who was convicted of treason, and the king Jeroboam ultimately would banish him from his kingdom. Now, Amos's words were ultimately rejected in Israel, but the thing of it was as his words were rejected, he wrote down what God wanted them to hear. And the beauty of it is his words have been preserved for generations to come. And the hope was as he wrote those words, future generations would read what he had to say and heed sort of the destruction that they were doomed for in the process. And his words were such that he wanted to make it very clear to them that they were basically self-indulgent and they were very prideful. And so we get to this first chapter in Amos 1, and we begin with verse 1, and this is what we read. The words of Amos, one of the sheep herders of Tekoa. The vision he saw concerning Israel 2 years before the earthquake, when Uzziah was king of Judah, and Jeroboam, son of Joash, the king, was king of Israel. And he said, the Lord roars from Zion and thunders from Jerusalem. The pastures of the shepherds dry up, and the top of Carmel withers. Now, we're pretty familiar maybe with the famous cookie maker, Amos, and we know him as Famous Amos. Well, this famous that we're going to be talking about over the next several weeks is not so famous. We see that he's this humble shepherd. He was in this small town close to the Dead Sea. It had a little bit of agriculture to it. It would be pretty hard to find it on a map. And like I said, it was pretty small, a lot like a lot of our towns around here. I'm just using Cloverdale as an example. This is where Amos was from. We even discover a little bit he wasn't necessarily a really good shepherd. And it also mentions that not only was he a shepherd, but he was also considered a farmer because he raised fig trees. But the beauty of who God is he takes someone like Amos, someone who is just this small-time shepherd, this fig tree farmer, if you want to call him that, and he was going to use him to minister to Israel. I think one of the other unique things about Amos is a lot of times a prophet came from maybe a lineage of prophets. Amos was not that kind of prophet. His background didn't have any of that beforehand. It was just simply God said, Amos, you're the one that I'm choosing. And again, as I said, it's about the same time that Jonah was sent out. And so there's a little bit of irony here that God took Jonah from Israel to send him to Nineveh to bring a message. And he has taken Amos right at this same time and said, you are going to bring a message to Israel. Now we jump to verse 3, and we are going to see how Amos sort of really sets the Israelites up, how he presents God's word. And in the end, I think we're going to discover that it was set up in such a way so that Israel would have a real wake-up call. Beginning in verse 3, it says this. This is what the Lord says. Now, I maybe want to point out just a little bit here that at first, as Amos is bringing this word, he's really talking about the enemies of Israel, all right? So this is what the Lord says. For three sins of Damascus, even for four, I will not relent, because she threshed Gilead with sledges having iron teeth. I will set fire on the house of Hazael that will consume the fortresses of Ben-Hadad. I will break down the gates of Damascus. I will destroy the king who is in the valley of Avon, the one who holds the scepter in Beth Eden. The people of Aram will go into exile to Kir, says the Lord. So we're getting this picture of God is not happy with Israel's enemies. All right? He's prophesying judgment on those enemies. And God is saying, you know, all you need to do is look and you can see the sins, you know, the three sins, the four sins, the multitudes of sin after sin after sin that they're committing. And he's saying, I'm going to bring judgment. And he's having Amos bring that message. It continues on in verse 6, and it says, this is what the Lord says. For three sins of Gaza, even for four, I will not relent, because she took captive whole communities and sold them to Edom. I will send fire on the walls of Gaza that will consume her fortresses. I will destroy the king of Ashdod and the one who holds the scepter in Ashkelon. I will turn my hand against Ekron till the last of the Philistines are dead, says the sovereign Lord. And again, we are continuing to hear him even talk more about the many enemies of Israel. And he goes on in verse 9 and he says, this is what the Lord says. For three sins of Tyre, even for four, I will not relent, because she sold whole communities of captives to Edom, disregarding a treaty of brotherhood. I will send fire on the walls of Tyre that will consume her fortresses. This is what the Lord says. For the three sins of Edom, even for four, I will not relent, because he pursued his brother with a sword and slaughtered the woman of the land, because his anger raged continually and his fury flamed unchecked. I will send fire on Teman that will consume the fortresses of Bozrah. This is what the Lord says. For three sins of Ammon, even for four, I will not relent, because he ripped open the pregnant women of Gilead in order to extend his borders. I will set fires to the walls of Raboth that will consume her fortresses amid war cries on the day of battle and violent winds on a stormy day. Her king will go into exile, he and his officials together, says the Lord. And he just continues to go on, and every time he does, he can just continues to point out the sin and the sins that are happening within these nations, and why God is saying, I am going to destroy you. I'm going to take you down because of what you are doing. And in chapter 2, he continues a little bit further here, and it says, this is what the Lord says. For three sins of Moab, even for four, I will not relent, because he burned to ashes the bones of Edom's king. I will send fire on Moab that will consume the fortresses of Kerioth. Moab will go down in great tumult amid war cries and the blast of the trumpet. I will destroy her ruler and kill all her officials with him, says the Lord. And so we are reading here in these first two chapters, Amos is pronouncing this judgment that is going to come down on many of Israel's enemies. And of course, you can imagine this is a message that Israel is loving to hear. You know, they're hearing it, and it's like, this is great news. We're in God's favor. We're on the right track with God, and look at what God is going to do to all of this nation. In fact, they were probably at the point where it's like, yeah, Amos, we love your message. Keep preaching it. Keep preaching it, because this is a good thing. And then Amos sort of changes his tone. And in chapter 2, verse 4, we read this. This is what the Lord says. For three sins of Judah, even for four, I will not relent, because they have rejected the law of the Lord. They have not kept his decrees, because they have been led astray by false gods, the gods their ancestors followed. I will send fire on Judah that will consume the fortresses of Jerusalem. So now, as Amos speaks, Amos is speaking of a nation that he is a part of. He is from Judah. So he's not excluding himself from sort of the sin after sin after sin. And because of that, they too are going to receive judgment from God. Now, this was a time in the nation when Israel had split. I don't know if you're familiar with that or not, but there was a split. And Israel was the northern kingdom. They remained Israel, and the southern kingdom was Judah. And so there was sort of this competition between the two of them over which one of these two was God's favorite. You know, Judah was saying, well, God likes us more than you, Israel. And Israel was saying, well, God likes us more than you, Judah. And of course, now as you hear Amos bringing these words against Judah, Israel is probably loving it. You know, they're thinking, yeah, we're better than Judah. You know, we're living out the way God wants us to live things out. God maybe likes us a little bit more. Maybe they're even, you know, thinking in their minds, we are God's favorites, you know, and all we needed was confirmation. And Amos, you have brought that confirmation to us. Again, they're probably saying, Amos, we love what you're saying. Go ahead, continue to preach it. And they're becoming pretty pumped up in their nationalistic pride. They're getting pretty big heads thinking, yeah, we've got it all together with God. But what's happening is God is setting them up to be knocked down. Now, I don't know how many of you ever remember the TV show, The A-Team. That was a long time ago, you know, with Mr. T. You know, the big black dude, he had the mohawk and he wore all the gold jewelry. And I always remembered his saying, "I pity the fool," you know, that mindset. But one of the things that usually happened in that TV show was often they would go out to sort of, you know, catch the bad guys. And at some point or another, there'd maybe be a fight that would take place, Mr. T, between him and the criminal of some sort or another. And a lot of times, Mr. T would sort of just let them punch him a little bit, and they would think maybe they were winning, like they're going to have the upper hand. And just like that, pow, with one punch, Mr. T would hit that enemy, and just like that, they would be down. I think that's what God is doing here with Amos. He's setting up Israel, and he's saying, making them think that they're winning. And then all at once, Amos' next words are going to be pow. And he's just going to knock them down. They get a Mr. T punch right to the face. So this is what we read in Amos chapter 2, verse 6, what the Lord says about the nation of Israel. It says, "For three sins of Israel, even for four, I will not relent. They sell the innocent for silver, the needy for a pair of sandals. They trample on the heads of the poor as on the dust of the ground and deny justice to the oppressed. Father and son use the same girl and so profane my holy name. They lie down beside every altar on garments taken in pledge. In the house of their God, they drink wine taken as fines. Yet I destroyed the Amorites before them, though they were tall as cedars and strong as the oaks. I destroyed their fruit above and their roots below. I brought you up out of Egypt and led you for 40 years in the wilderness and gave you the land of the Amorites. I also raised up prophets from among your children, the Nazirites from among your youths. Is it not true, people of Israel, declares the Lord? But you made the Nazirites drink wine and commanded the prophets not to prophesy. Now then, I will crush you as a cart crushes when loaded with grain. The swift will not escape. The strong will not muster their strength. The warrior will not save his life. The archer will not stand his ground. The fleet-footed soldier will not get away. The horseman will not save his life. Even the bravest warriors will flee naked on that day, declares the Lord." And so now Amos is getting really to the heart of the matter. He's saying, "Israel, I'm calling you out on the sins that you are committing, the things that you have done. And I'm giving you a warning," and he's saying, if you don't figure it out, if you don't get it right, what he's saying is his judgment is going to come from God. And just as he did with the other nations, we see that Amos sort of lists those sins, those things that they are doing. In verse 6, he says, "They sell the innocent for silver, the needy for a pair of sandals." What we start to see is a nation that is more concerned about money and possessions than they are about the people themselves. If someone's poor, if someone is oppressed, if someone's in need, they're like, "Who cares?" It's more about what can we get, what can we receive, what can we be about. In verse 7, "They trample the heads of the poor as the dust of the ground. They deny justice to the oppressed." And what we start to see is a nation that is very self-absorbed. They were all about themselves. They didn't care about maybe those little people or those people that were less privileged. It was about what can we gain? How much better can we be? And then he talks about really the sexual immorality that's taking place there. Father and son use the same girl, probably a reference to the temple prostitutes. And that they were not only sexually immoral, but probably sexually abusive. And they were powerful. Again, they were taking advantage of the weak. And then he goes on and he talks about how they're profaning his name, whether it's in the gods that they worship or the things that they were doing within the temple. And then in verse 8, he continues, they lie down beside every altar on garments taken in pledge. In the house of the God, they drink wine taken as fines. Again, they're taking what is not rightfully theirs, and they're using it for their benefit, for their own comfort, for their own purposes. And so what Amos is doing here is he's given a picture to Israel of their self-indulgence. He's given them an actual picture of what the state of Israel is really about, what's happening. And this is a nation that thought they had it all together. This is a nation that they just thought, you know, God loves us and God cares for us and we're chosen by God. And of course, he's given us all these wonderful things. And so, you know, we're right with where we need to be. But they were so self-absorbed. They were so focused on what gain could they get that they ultimately were blinded to what they were really doing. They were so far ultimately away from the heart of God. We see God reminding them of what he did in the past. As they wandered through the desert and as they were able to start to defeat and conquer nations.